here in Cognom at the Nexon Arena for your first round of playoffs. It's me, Valdez, with Wolf. As always, we're going to be jumping into this one. Dark versus Deer, the battle of the D's.
That's
going
right.
Head-to-head.
They are going head-to-head. This is going to be a great series. Can Deer go into another final here? He hasn't been in a Korean final since 2013. Winning this won't guarantee him that spot. He'll then have to win a Protoss versus Protoss in order to get that top spot. But Dark is the last Zerg hope in this tournament. And, you know, this is a very exciting matchup because last time they played, Deer dominated Dark. But this time it feels like Dark is the favorite. And we could talk a lot about why as we go into this series. But underperforming Dark in the last time they faced. But Deer has the advantage in terms of regular season with these two. So exciting to see how this one plays out because Deer has made several round of fours in his career but has never actually been able to break through with the exception of that 2013 season.
I think if there is going to be another season where he has a big shot of, you know, getting a big result, I think this is going to be it because he's on this, like, rocketing run up through Challenge into Premier. We weren't sure what to expect, right? I was expecting more out of guys like Hero, who also came from Challenge, but unfortunately got, I think, around 7th place or something like that. But Deer was the big surprise coming through, winning so many of his matches and able to get up into 3rd place in total was really fantastic for this guy. So I feel like there is a lot of hype behind him. There is some pressure that you have to deal with as Deer as well because, you know, everybody's questioning, is he back? You know, is he actually going to challenge for the championship this time around? But I'm not so sure. He's got a really hard opponent ahead of him in Dark, and I don't think it's going to look anything like that best of three that they played.
That's right. And Dark also, remember, has so much SSL experience. He's made it very deep in this tournament. This will be his 3rd time making it this far. He's a 2-time finalist. He is a champion of SSL as well. Deer has never made it this far in an SSL. He's been knocked out early every time. So definitely the underdog today, and Dark has been more successful overall recently in StarCraft 2. But this is Deer's breakout tournament. Can he make it happen? That's what we're about to find out.
Yeah, me and you did another After Hours video about our predictions for this matchup. But just to sum it up for you guys, if you haven't seen it, I did go ahead and guess 4-1 for Dark. Wolf guessed 4-2 for Dark, so definitely seems like the expected winner from this matchup should be Dark, but really it depends on what kind of Deer is going to show up, right? Is he going to I'm getting this group invite as I'm talking. Is he going to be this fantastic Deer that 2-0s Dark, or is he just going to fall flat on his face as he has had at some points in big tournaments?
Yeah, I mean, that's the big question. I think that's going to be the story of the series, no doubt. There will definitely be some epic moments. There will definitely be some great opening starts in this first game. But before we get to it, guys, we're going to jump to an interview. Check it out.
GSL에서는 4강을 많이 갔었는데 SSL에서는 항상 좀 빨리 떨어져가지고 많이 아쉬웠는데 이번에 이렇게 올라오게 돼서 더 기쁜 것 같아요.
사실 민수랑 할 때 민수한테 좀 화가 많이 났었는데 민수가 너무 개념에서 벗어난 걸로 하더라고요. 마음이 편해서 그런지 좀 화가 많이 났었는데 도우 형이 이제 제 마음을 많이 치유해 주셨죠.
저는 오히려 령호가 더 편한 것 같아요. 왜냐면 이제 약간 도장 깨기 식으로 적으로 프로토스를 깨부수는 식이라서. 그런데 적으 전이 저도 힘들긴 하지만 그래도 열심히 해서 꼭 적으는 없애고 프로토스끼리 스타운판을 만들고 싶어요. 사실 챌린지에서 막 그렇게 압도적인 성적으로 올라온 게 아니어서 기대는 그렇게 저도 제 자신한테 크게 하지는 않았는데 프리미어 잘하는 선수들끼리 붙어서 그래도 성적 이 정도면 잘 낸 것 같고 앞으로 뭐 더 이제 남은 경기가 더 중요한 것 같아요. 그래서 푸저전이 저는 굉장히 토스가 좀 안 좋다고 생각하는데 안 좋다고 뭐 부정만 할 수는 없으니까요. 꼭 저그전 해법을 찾아서 네, 박량우 선수 꼭 이기고 싶네요.
어제 또 보셨다시피 결승 한 자리는 이미 토스거든요. 다 아실 거예요. 토스들의 징징이 얼마나 심한지. 최후의 승리자는 토스거든요, 항상.
저는 풀세트 가지 않을까 싶어요. 4대 3으로 제가 이길 것 같아요.
동준이 형이 좀 배제를 잘 하시는 것 같더라고요. 근데 뭐 그땐 3판 2선이고 지금은 7판 4선으로 이뤄지는 다전제다 보니까 질 것 같은 생각은 안 들어요. 그래서 4대 1? 동준이 형은 이제 그 토스 대장을 물리치러 가기 전에 워밍업이니까 그냥 가볍게 좀 이기고 올라갈게요.
네, 저도 근데 그렇게 생각하고 근데 최근에 제가 영호 한번 이겨봤기 때문에 네, 그 자신감으로 네, 게임해야 될 것 같아요. 영호야, 최근에 내가 이겼으니까 그대로만 가자.
동준이 형, 민수랑 할 때처럼만 해주세요.
Really cool video we did just have there between Dark and Deer. A little bit of trash talk at the end even. I would have to agree with Dark as we were saying before, right? He's looking more towards Classic and Stats, who because of Classic actually, Dark is even in the playoffs because he 2-0'd Innovation in a surprising result in their last matchup. So he's thanking Classic, wants to take him out, wants to get the stats, but does have to get through Deer here first.
So let's take a look at the head-to-head. As much as Dark is absolutely the favorite, historically between these two in the Samsung SKT matchup in Pro League, it was not always Dark that got the better of them. He's only one ahead in 10-9 currently. Deer has the advantage in Legacy of the Void after taking that 2-0 sweep in their regular season match. So Deer has the regular season advantage as well, 2-0. But let's not forget, even Deer admitted in that interview basically saying, please play like you did in that series again because it was an underperforming series from Dark. A lot of mistakes in terms of controlling his overlord management with his larva, and oftentimes just poor control mistakes overall and dealing with late game harass. So, you know, is Dark the favorite tonight? If you look at that series alone, you probably don't think so, but I think if you look at overall history, you would say yes.
Yeah, would have to agree. And it seems like our fans on Facebook also do agree. 93-40 in the lead there was Dark. But even Dark said it in his interview as well. He feels like Deer is very good with his build selection. I feel like we are going to see a couple of surprises. I don't know if it's going to be Dark Shrine in the main base of Byul kind of surprise, but some weird builds are going to happen. It's a best of seven. It's Deer against Zerg.
Yeah.
Some of these games are going to look a little bit strange, I would have to say.
Yeah, exactly. It's a best of seven, which means the depth of builds will go very deep. Remember, this will be the fifth time Deer makes a top four in a domestic tournament here in Korea. He has four top fours in GSL. Three of them he failed to make grand finals. The fourth one where he did, of course, the 2013 finals he did win. He was successful. That's his only Star League victory he's ever had. And he did, of course, win WCS right afterwards for Season 3 in 2013, but it wasn't a domestic tournament here in Korea. And this will now be his fifth time making top four in a Korean league here. And he needs to win two best of sevens to make the grand finals. It's just the first step of many. And of course, his opponent, Dark, remember, he's the last Zerg hope. So if you don't like Protoss versus Protoss, he's definitely who you're rooting for here. He is a two-time SSL finalist. And the player who defined this matchup back in 2016 in Season 1, he defeated Stats in the Zerg versus Protoss using Baneling Hydra, showing depth of builds. And perhaps this is just the beginning of what he's going to start to show us. Maybe he'll show us something new again in this gauntlet.
Yeah. It's interesting to take a look at his results from all of Season 2. You can see that he did decently well against the Terrans, especially taking out Innovation in a big match, 2-1, famously. But against the Protosses, he's had a little bit of trouble. Did go down to Hero, who was in 7th place. Lost to Stats, who's in 1st. I mean, that's not too hard. But then he did go down to Deer. The only one that he did take out was Classic, 2-1. So a little bit of inconsistency in the matchup for Season 2. So we'll see if any of that really comes out in this best of seven.
Absolutely. Remember, he didn't get through into this playoffs by his own volition. It was due to the upset win there that you were describing earlier. So now big shoes to fill. He's made it into the top four. He has the hardest road through the gauntlet. Deer gets an advantage in map selection as well because he had the higher seed.
And you can already see Deer looking a little bit more nervous. Dark looking very composed before we do get into this first game. We are going to be jumping onto Newkirk Precinct for game number one. So go out there, tell your friends this is on. We got a huge best of seven, Deer versus Dark. Let's get into it. Fly, better fly, Jin Air. Here we are on map number one. This is Newkirk Precinct down in the bottom right. This is one of our Protoss players, Deer.
And his opponent to the bottom left, it is Dark, took fourth seed. As a result, the map advantage will go to Deer. Dark is forbidden one map choice on the map draft, and also the first map was given to Deer. It is his first map choice, so Newkirk Precinct is one of the maps where we'll certainly see something prepared, you have to imagine. Remember, Deer has shown so many different builds throughout this tournament. I feel like that was his strength more than his macro play, more than perhaps even mind games, was his creative nature of how he opened up these games. The strategies he showed us from start to finish, his play against Innovation, the Proxy Robo, the Dark Shrine in the main base you were describing, he's shown such a variety of builds. And that's one thing we have to give him an edge over Dark in this best of seven. Perhaps, yes, maybe Dark has the better mechanics, maybe he has a better understanding of certain timings, how to defend them, how to counterattack. But in terms of openings, Deer definitely has more.
Yeah, it would be pretty crazy if he was actually able to take this best of seven with just a bunch of those builds that he brings out. I mean, we haven't really had someone be able to do that in a very long time. Someone that's very tricky and comes in and does crazy builds. The only other player I can really think of is SOS, but I feel like in a lot of the best of sevens, he doesn't do like absolutely insane builds that he does in SSL Challenge or anything like that. He's a little bit more solid overall, I would have to say.
Yeah.
But no, it would be pretty cool. I think you actually said in After Hours that Deer would have to take game one in order to really have a shot of taking this best of seven.
I do agree. And I mean, historically, it's always been statistically proven. And just because of how math works, sure, there's an advantage. But there's also the extra factor to winning game one of a best of seven, winning game one of a grand finals or a gauntlet match like this. It gets into your opponent's head and it does affect the outcome of the match. Also, losing the first game, if you're an emotional player like Deer, is much more emotional than Dark, but it can actually have a bigger impact to the losing player in that case. Probe wanted to get a secondary follow-up scout, but we'll be chased out here. So the way that the last series went between these two was basically tempo pressure from Deer, oftentimes skipping second oracles to actually make a few adepts with a few hidden gateways to try to kill drones to get a tempo advantage for a larger push. In game two, he tried to do the sentry drop, tried to wall off the ramp and kill Dark that way. It ended up failing, but it forced such a reaction out of Dark that Deer always had the tempo advantage. And he was trying to force those advantages to lead him to a smooth late game where he had massive base advantages. That's where he saw those crazy zealot run by his huge warp-ins with the warp prisms. So you have to imagine on this map, Deer is trying to get an early lead to try to look for a late game base advantage, which is how he won that series against Dark when they faced each other just 2 weeks ago.
Yeah, it's interesting because Newkirk Precinct is his most picked map, and I was thinking maybe he was thinking about some kind of mind game, like, hey, I did that crazy Dark Shrine build on this map to BL, so you know, you better keep an eye out. Maybe he's trying to get Dark safe and behind and get those small advantages you were talking about. So far, it's looking pretty normal, and Dark can see that it's looking pretty normal with this Stargate that is scouted by the Overlord. Got the first Oracle making its way out. Will this just be one Stargate, or will we actually get some craziness in this game and perhaps see the return of triple Stargate a little bit later on?
That would be exciting. I think there's definitely a chance we see that in this series because it's going to be such a long one. With the Void Ray here, it leads towards that direction. We've always seen the Void Ray lead into that triple Stargate Oracle production. First Oracle will be spotted a long way away. Probably just have to trade down two drones here, then get out with shields. Only a little bit of hit points there.
You were like so close to getting that exactly correct, Wolf. I was impressed. You got the two drones.
Double Stargate. Will it be the triple?
I think it should. I mean, you generally see a commitment to three if you're going to see two.
So commit for two more here. Looks like. Oh, only gets the one.
Oh, that was really close. The other queen, though, coming in, and that went down.
Yep.
That definitely died, yeah. So there you go. First Oracle is dead.
Observer checked like four different ways just to confirm its death. When it disappears on the UI, you know it's gone forever. Now a few lings coming across the map. This is actually twofold useful for Dark because he can identify the third base, because normally a third base would have been made by now on Newkirk with oracles for the defense. So he sees, okay, it's not only not at the normal third base, but it's not at the hidden third base at the 3 o'clock. So even though he hasn't seen the additional Stargates, he can reasonably assume something like this is coming. But if he incorrectly assumes that it's actually going to be a follow-up gateway attack or something like that, then he might be in trouble. He is making the right choice, though. Making extra drones, getting a Hydroden, just adding Spore Crawlers to be safe. Additional ones, in fact.
Yeah. I mean, you have to imagine with Dark going up against potentially three different Protoss players that the only matchup he's playing right now is ZVP, right? I mean, this guy, he needs to focus against Protoss as he wants to win another SSL. And so maybe even just a small thing like the timing of the third is very indicative of, okay, this guy is going for the triple Stargate or at least some kind of extra tech build. And so Dark is like, okay, let's prepare for this. This is something that I've been expecting.
All right, going to end up losing a queen here regardless, though. Let's see if he just wants to go for queen kills. That's going to be the targets for now. As two Adepts actually find their way into this third base, the Lings were away. He's going to target down the Spore Crawler. Queen's nearby. Void Ray will go down, but this means he can just target Queen's here, and it's a shooting gallery.
Yeah, no transfuse on the Spore, just nothing able to get these guys to live. And now those Adepts are finally going to be cleaned up. But will he have an answer for the triple Oracle coming in here? We got number 4 and number 5 making their way. They're going to snipe down these Hydras.
Yeah, just kidding them while they're in small numbers. They need a critical mass to fight the Oracles directly. This isn't even triple Stargate Oracle. It's just double Stargate. He's down to one queen now. And this is the exact type of tempo advantages that Deer got in the series. They faced off against each other last time. Now there's enough Zealots here to deal with the Ling run by. So nothing gained from Dark, and now Deer has a massive advantage. And sure, Dark's making the answer, but he's going to struggle with this Larva now after losing all those drones, losing all those queens. He hasn't even started to replace them yet.
I mean, this is exactly what we were talking about, this early advantage from Deer, a wacky build, right? Not even just one Stargate or three, it's two. And man, now these Oracles are all going to be left alive. They're going to be a huge threat out on the map. It's three base versus three base. Dark barely can even saturate a fourth base, even if he was able to get that up. It looks like he's just going to stick on three for now as he goes for Infestation Pit. Seems like kind of the emergency build response by Dark here.
Yeah. Ooh, one Oracle does go down. Definitely going to help in the short term here, dealing with these, but the gateway fall with charge plus one and probably just going to be Templar Archives into Archons is going to be so great for Deer. Now, this fourth base is how Deer played the same sort of play style against Dark, not with the Oracles, but with the depth pressure, with just a little bit of Oracle harass off one Stargate. This is his approach to dealing with Dark, is getting small advantages leading into larger games where he doesn't actually go all in with the Oracles. Remember, he only did two Stargates. He has this timing where he's going to try to keep Dark at bay, but he's not going to all in with it. He takes another Nexus, is going to build up an economy with a large amount of gateways to use Warp Prisms to harass in the late game. And he already has the infrastructure to, if the game goes longer, deal with Broodlords. He has Stargates already. All he needs is a Fleet Beacon. He's in really good shape, but he's not going to just try to end this game now. He's looking towards the future.
Actually got a quick look on whether or not Deer saw that Infestation Pit. Looks like the answer was no. So a decent amount of tech is being hidden right now from Deer. He doesn't know exactly what the transition is going to be from Dark. Does see a bunch of Hydras right now, and I think he did see that. Yeah, he saw that fourth as well, so we'll see if he has any timing or if he's just going to wait back, wait for some upgrades, get some Archons out, try to secure a fourth base here.
Though Infestors are incredibly good at this comp, or good at dealing with this comp, because they can literally put Zealots in their place where they can't actually get into melee range, and obviously they will catch the Oracles in the sky. Oracles don't have high range, so the Hydras just pick this army off. He has a good few Fungals, so this game was massively in Deer's favor. He has a large army here, but if he actually gets caught by Fungals, it could all end here. It's not invincible with this comp. He sees the Infestors, but it's too late. Oracles are caught.
Look at those Fungals on everything. Is he going to have enough, though?
Yeah,
those Fungals aren't enough, and look at that, the Archons in the front. They were cool Fungals, but Deer says, yeah, I don't care.
GG. Didn't chain the Fungals together. Brought the army in too close to the range of the Oracles. And either way, probably would have been a win for Deer. His army was much larger. This is what Deer needed. He needed a good build here in game number one. He got the success with his Oracles to get the early damage done, to kill those Queens with the Void Ray commitment there. He hit the tech. Dark didn't know what it was. Was only half as safe as he should have been. And now Deer absolutely, with this first dominant win in game number one on his map pick, the seed advantage he had to send us to this map in the first place, things are still very much a high possibility Deer gets out of this first stage. If I feel like if the build failed, if he had some poor execution, I'd be starting to worry for him already in that game, given that he prepared this build so much, he picked this map, he cared about it the most, but he won. And now I feel like there's chances to get higher and higher of getting out of this.